Travelling the world with a race car is no easy feat, especially when you're doing it by yourself. We're here with Feras in your Corvette to get some more insight into being a successful privateer. So, in the past we have covered this car, so I'd urge people to go look at that video if they want to get a full kind of rundown on it. But can we just first of all cover some of the recent changes that you've made?
Sure, yeah. There's not too many changes we made for this event. One of the big changes was adding weight to the car. In order to be legal to run this size tire, we had to weigh a certain amount of weight, and for us it was 29.78, and we were running in the low 26s, so we had to roughly add 350 pounds to the car. So that was probably the biggest change I had to make for the event. Besides that, it's relatively the same as, you know, I ran it at Grid Life, Gingerman, and at Road Atlanta, with some small stuff aero-wise, but, you know, that's really about it.
So adding that weight, how's that done? Ballast of some sort, I'm assuming you're adding it low on the car and where you want it?
Yeah, so I got some 50 pound lead bricks and added one of those below the rear transaxle, and then the rest in the passenger seat. I tried originally to put it all in the rear to help it dig out of corners, and I went testing and it didn't really like that. It kind of just sent me right off track. I couldn't catch the rear end in time. So now I just put it all in the passenger seat and just kept that 50 pounds in the back.
So keeping the weight distribution where you want it, and also the center of gravity as low as possible. Another one of the big changes visually, the car's a bit of a different color to we saw it last. The body panels have changed. What's been done there?
Yeah, so we got the HGK carbon Kevlar kit. It's their drift body, and I really just solely chose it just for weight purposes. It was 80 pounds lighter than the full carbon body that I had. On top of that, it looks great, so.
Yeah, definitely looks really good. Made for drifting, carbon Kevlar is also pretty robust.
Yeah, I'd say. I mean, we're not trying to take any hits, but in drifting, they take some good hits.
I guess that's a good security to have just in case.
Yeah.
For yourself, like I discussed, you're privateer, you're doing most things by yourself. You built the car a lot by yourself. How do you manage all of that work, understanding the different areas of the vehicle, the different skills you need to have, and then also planning to, you know, bring the car from the States here to Sydney?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know how I really manage it or if I manage it well, but, you know, I try to start off with a good chassis and a platform that would be somewhat reliable. And, you know, I think that's kind of half the battle. And then I just kind of make it a point to have a schedule in place and that to know, okay, I have to have the car ready for this event and I have this amount of time to do it. So besides that, it's actually a lot of work. I don't know if any of it's really easy. It's just like a lot of late nights in the garage to try to just make sure you make it to that event.
Yeah, it's unsurprising, really. I think most people would expect it to be a lot of work. When you're preparing, I mean, you've come here to Sydney, obviously never run this track before, but you've done this a fair amount, moving to different tracks, and you've been really successful setting lap records and so forth. How do you prepare to come to a new track? Are you using a simulator?
Yeah, so I have just like stuff off Amazon for a sim, but I really just use it to like learn sight and kind of just car placement for the track. It's a totally different animal to drive this thing versus really anything on the sim. Sometimes I'll drive like the Indy car or something just to try to get me a little bit faster than what my car is doing. Typically around a course like in the US, I'm about 10 seconds slower than Indy car. So it kind of gives me a little bit faster pace than what I need. But if I drive anything else that's remotely, you know, close to what this could be, it kind of ends up throwing me off. So typically Indy car driving would be the way to go on the sim to prep for the track.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. Adjusting your brain for something a bit faster pace, so when you get to this, I wouldn't say it would be more relaxed, but
yeah,
digestible.
I mean, yeah, because if you're taking everything slower, you know, if you take it faster, then at least you can slow it down. But your hands are moving so quickly, your eyes are moving so fast and like looking so far ahead. If you're already training yourself to do that even further, then it's a lot easier to slow it down.
And just a bit of insight, for example, you come here, we have a testing day and then 2 days of competition. How many laps are you turning here before the competition starts?
I mean, it's tough, right? Because you make it all this way and you want to set decent pace in practice, but yet you don't want to hurt the car. So it was a fine balance. You know, I ran it relatively on low boost. For the very last session, I ran it on like a 900 horsepower map, just to kind of get me like that mile per hour sensation into the corners, get my braking points a little bit more defined. But you know, I'm still figuring it out. It's so tough, especially in competition, to come and try to figure out a track and be competitive. It's like there couldn't be any more pressure on you. So, you know, when all these guys have been here and, you know, they've been here for years, they live here, run this track forever, it's a lot on someone who hasn't. So I'm just trying my best. Every time I go out, I pick a corner. I might perfect one and then I ruin the next. So it's like, I don't know if I'll ever leave here like really feeling like I got it, but, you know, maybe we can come back next year.
And the nature of the vehicle, being a time attack vehicle, you've obviously got to limit the time, because it's designed, it's fairly high strung to run at a limit, and not really designed around like endurance racing, so you're considering that as well.
I mean, it's tough, right? So I tried to go out on a different set of tires earlier, and they didn't suit the track well. And so now I'm just like in conserve mode, right? Try to conserve what I have, but still make laps. So it's a fine balance.
And the actual changes to the vehicle as you come to the track in terms of setup and things like that, what would you expect to make when you come to a new track and adjust the car and kind of dial it in? I guess you have limited time to make those decisions as well.
Yeah, so like I spoke with Ian before I came out, and I just asked him, hey, how's the track surface? Is it smooth, relatively bumpy? What's going on? And he was like, I don't know, man. So I'm like, great. So I just sent it the way I normally drive the car in the US. I haven't made a single change to the car. So I haven't done anything with suspension at all. The only thing I changed was tires, and I went right back to what I had on it. I need to learn so much, right? All the changes I think if I made behind the wheel would benefit way more than trying to change the car. So I keep that consistent and just try to perfect on myself on driving.
That makes a lot of sense. And coming here as a privateer, shipping the vehicle here or moving it around the States and the world in general, how do you decide what equipment and parts to bring? Is it a bit of a balancing act, I'm sure?
Man, that's a tough one, right? Because we were in a container of three. There's three cars, you know, in that container, and we had a limited space to pack spares. So tires were a priority, you know, so I sent tires, and, you know, I have these two, like, 50-gallon totes on wheels, and that was kind of it. I just like anything that I might have had failures in the past with, sensors, you know, little things that are hard to find, I just sent with a car, a lot of tools, and just random stuff, really. I didn't bring any like big ticket items just because I didn't feel like we had the space. Also the expense behind it, if I wanted to bring a spare engine, a spare trans, stuff like that. Luckily, like my transmission, their PPG is Australia. So I was like, okay, well, worst case, I can talk to those guys. And they luckily had some spares here for me if need be. But I just figured, hey, you know, take it easy, just make some laps, and you know, if you can, save the boost for the very end. Or if I never feel comfortable enough and I never figure out, probably won't try to salvage a lap with boost. So.
And I guess it comes back to what you said before as well, with the foundations of the car being built to be a strong platform. So hopefully you're not making any major mechanical failures.
Yeah, hopefully not. We'll keep our fingers crossed.
And just one other thing we just discussed before, you've done some aero testing this morning on the vehicle. Can you just talk through that a little bit?
Oh, yeah, it was so cool, man. Kyle Engineering came over and we chatted a bit last night, and he's like, yeah, I got Flow Viz if you want to Flow Viz the car. And I was like, that would be awesome. I've never spent wind tunnel time or nothing like that. So this is a Feras Engineering wing, and you know, he Flow Viz it, and he Flow Viz this diffuser, which originally was from DeSoul Designs, and I just made it out of his mold. Yeah, there was like separation only where this tape is, because I use tape on everything. there was just a slight bit of separation right in the middle here, but everything else was completely attached, and he's like, it couldn't get any better than this. So it's good to know that I chose the right company to work with to design this wing. The homemade aero stuff that I've just thought would work is actually working.
So that's obviously really reassuring. Just to clarify, people who are not familiar with Flow Viz, it's essentially a paint
a paint that flows as you speed up, and then it dries. So that way you can see and make sure like if it's attaching or not. So if airflow is attached, you'll see like streaks of the paint with it. And if it detaches or something, you'll see the separation marks of it.
Cool. Well, thanks for that. Thanks for your time. If people want to follow along with what you're doing, your journey, going to all these different tracks and running the vehicle, where are they best to do so?
I'd say I really just do everything on Instagram. So it's just at Feras_Qartoumy.
Perfect. Thanks for your time.
Yeah, for sure. Thanks, man.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.